the News Channel 5 Network. This is Open Line.
Good Thursday evening, everyone. Rhori Johnston with you here on News Channel 5. Time for Open Line. It is our chance to give you an opportunity to call in on a topic of interest. And I think we're going to get some calls tonight because we are going to talk about the very latest in the impeachment trial of President Trump. And joining me as our special guest tonight from Vanderbilt University is Dr. Thomas Schwartz, a professor of history, political science, So on and so forth, sir. Good to see you.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for having me on the program.
737 plus, folks, we want you to call in. And let me just say this on the outset. I know people have some strong opinions about this. And, of course, we want you to share your opinions about what you've seen so far in this impeachment trial and what you think is going to happen. But let's do it respectfully if we can. I'll just put that out there right now. So go ahead and call in. And Taylor in the back room will put you on hold and we'll get you through. In the meantime, let's talk about the latest developments. You know, I was just reading the latest Associated Press developments in this trial, which could be headed to a conclusion as early as tomorrow. Is that correct?
That's right. No, they're going to continue to hear questions tonight and then tomorrow discuss, debate the question of whether to call witnesses.
Right.
And if that is rejected, then Speaker McConnell could really, or Senator McConnell could bring that really quickly to a head and ask for a vote on both of the articles of impeachment.
Let's talk about the makeup of the United States Senate right now. Mm-hmm. 53 Republicans, correct?
Yes, that's right.
And really, it's Angus King is an independent who caucuses with Bernie Sanders is an independent, caucuses with the Democrats. So technically, 47 Democrats.
47 Democrats.
But we have a number of those moderate Republicans who, for a number of days now, including my old friend, Senator Susan Collins of Maine, who, when I started my career, she was just coming up through the ranks. Susan Collins. We've got Mitt Romney. We've got Lisa Murkowski out of Alaska. Yeah. And of course, we've got our own Lamar Alexander, who's been mentioned in the mix, who doesn't politically have anything to lose.
Right.
He's on his way out. Mm-hmm. What is Mitch McConnell dealing with here as far as votes and how many he needs and doesn't need?
Well, I think he's, it seems from what we're hearing, that he feels he has the votes. But it also seems that the three that you mentioned, now outside of Alexander,
Collins, Murkowski,
and Romney, are going to vote for witnesses.
Right.
So he must be thinking that he's going to get a 50-50 vote, or that he has the possibility of a couple of Democrats.
Joe Manchin,
maybe. And
who else was on the
senator from Alabama,
red state chef?
Doug. I want to say Doug Jones, but I'm not sure.
We'll figure it out. The senator from Alabama. Who is from a red state.
Who is from a red state, was elected in a sort of unusual situation because of the person he ran against, and is up for re-election this year. So there is that slim possibility, or else he just feels he's got a tie vote, 50-50, and that a tie vote in this sense would be a loss for the calling of witnesses, and therefore would be, he could move ahead.
Let's go over the debate that they've been having about whether or not to call witnesses. On the one side, Republicans say this is not how an impeachment process works. The House, it was their jurisdiction, their responsibility to call the witnesses. They had months and months to do this. And if they did an incomplete job, too bad. It's not the Senate's job. The other side is saying, the House managers are saying, new information has come to light.
Right.
A lot of new information. And if we're going to really uncover, look under every stone here, it's part of our due diligence, right?
And especially because of the revelations about John Bolton, and that sort of shaken things up. There was a little bit when the news of Lev Parnas and some of that material came out, but I think John Bolton's work and John Bolton's memoir being out there, and the fact that it's fairly clear that he saw this, the president's deal on Ukraine as being exactly what the accusation is, I think that has certainly stirred things up.
I mean, he was national security advisor.
He was in the room.
Closer
to the president than that. Right.
Okay, so the process itself, you know, I've told as many people as possible, you may find it boring, but watch some of it at least, because this is history.
Yeah.
This is the machinations of our government and how our founders wanted this to work, and it's only what, third time in the history, and or third time.
Yeah.
And the last time was, you know, I was younger and just starting out in the business and don't really recall a lot. Well, we didn't have, you know, in the 90s for the Clinton trial, we didn't have the 24-hour news cycles as we do now.
Right.
We had CNN, but... So watch, and it's been very interesting, especially the questions that no one speaks. They write them down. They're following exactly the way it's supposed to be, right?
Right. No, it's it's an old fashioned, obviously made well before a lot of more modern things. The idea of writing the questions, bringing them up, having them stated. But yes, it's a sort of quaint approach, and it does provide some drama.
Yeah. How do you take these current events in this unique situation, and then turn around into your curriculum with your students and try to, you know, use this as a teaching tool?
Well, it's
difficult. Are you watching it with your students? Are you discussing it?
It's difficult. There's not a high level of interest.
Really?
No.
And
part of that is that I think it's because people are so certain the president's going to be acquitted. There's not the sort of sense of drama that there was, say, about the Kavanaugh hearings, where you had real sort of that did grip students. They watched the different testimony and all the rest, and they knew there was a certain uncertainty there about the votes.
And that came down to Susan Collins.
Came down to Susan Collins.
Her big speech that she gave.
And I think here there doesn't seem to be that sense of drama. Now it might heighten if there is a sense that the witness vote will go against. And open up some new possibilities. Mm-hmm. But I think right now, unless there's some change, unless that changes and you get actual witnesses, I don't think there's going to be a great deal of interest.
737-PLUS is the phone number, everyone. Want to know what you think about the impeachment trial of President Trump. Do you think it was even necessary in the first place? Do you think that these charges are impeachable offenses or not? How do you think both sides have done handling this situation? If you've been watching it, give us a call. Let us know. 737-PLUS. I've heard both praise and a little bit of criticism for both sides, the House managers, the president's defense, specific people, whether it's Pat Cipollone or Adam Schiff. What do you think about the job that they've done? I mean, it's hard work. There's a lot of research. There's pages and pages of, you know, they've got, and especially with this Q&A, they've got to be ready to stand up.
They do. I think it's been a harder, I think it's a harder job for the president's defenders because the case seems to shift. The president said at first he did nothing wrong at all, but then in a way they have to deal with the fact that there is a fair amount of evidence that this Ukrainian thing was there was a political element.
Yeah, and you're hearing a lot of them saying, well, even if it was, you're hearing a lot of quid pro.
That's right.
Here is our argument for that, why you should vote to acquit and whatnot.
Yeah.
Alan Dershowitz has been criticized pretty widely for a pretty, you know, eye-raising claim that he made yesterday about the constitutionality of this and basically kind of giving the president free rein, saying if the president thinks his re-election is in the best interest of the country and so on and so forth. Do you think that the criticism is warranted?
I think he put
it in backtracked.
He's backtracked a bit, and he said he's been distorted. He's not wrong to say that every president thinks their re-election is in the national interest. He's not wrong about that. That's simply fact.
That's politics.
That's politics. The problem is, of course, that he sort of extended it and said that this doesn't make it impeachable. And I think that's where the confusion set in, that, you know, that he was pushing this. And it reminded people, of course, of one of Richard Nixon's most famous statements, that if the president does it, it's legal.
Yeah.
And that is ironic, of course.
Right. No one is above the law.
No one is above the law. So,
all right, let's go to our lines. We got some callers in. We really appreciate it. Let's first start with Larry. Hey, Larry.
Yes, sir.
Hey, welcome. Thanks for calling in.
I just have a comment.
Sure.
I can't understand why, if the man is innocent, why doesn't he put witnesses on and let them tell their story, whether it be redacted or not. I mean, there are certain people up there that can watch, that can read all of the information and not reveal any state secrets or anything like that, but just let them have a complete investigation and get on with it. That's all I have to say.
Okay. thank you for the comment. We appreciate it very much, Larry, for calling in. I think he's talking a little bit about this, the witness swap that's been debated, that Mitch McConnell has said to Chuck Schumer, if we end up voting for witnesses, or if you want with it, then we should be able to call our witnesses. And they're trying to drag the Bidens in, and
which
people are definitely seeing as this is going to be this political, where is the end game here, and how long will this go? Do you think that's enough to sway the few of those senators who may be on the fence, say, we don't want to see this, the country doesn't need this?
There is something, I think that the fact that there's not been a deal, you know, some sort of a deal on witnesses, does lead me to think that both sides don't want to have it happen. It underlying, I mean, the Democrats would love to have it, their witnesses. Republicans, I think, would be less enthusiastic about it, but obviously they're going to put up a fight on it.
Yeah.
So it does lead me to think that they don't really want to do this. But the caller's point that they should have witnesses, I think, is that's going to be one of the things that could hurt the president in his reelection campaign. If this gets shut down without witnesses, I think you will have the Democrats using that as the cover-up argument during the campaign, and that could hurt.
Oh, yeah. They'll definitely go for that. All right. We are going to go for a quick commercial break. We've got several callers on hold. Hang in. We'll get to your calls right after this. We appreciate it. And we've got more lines open on 737 Plus. Open Line will be right back.